Anyone who pays a visit to Rome will discover that they become in no time a pilgrim, for it is in the spirit of a pilgrimage to art and to faith that we find ourselves in this remarkable city, the capital of Christianity. The story of Rome, down through the centuries, has earned it the title of the Eternal City. We hope to guide you through the glowing red terracotta of its Etruscan temples and the white marble splendor of the palaces of the Caesars, the sumptuous thermal baths, the theaters and the amphitheaters. To this city came the apostles Peter and Paul from faraway Palestine to carry into the heart of the Roman Empire the word of Christ. It was here that they received the palm of martyrdom, and here that the Renaissance exploded. Its greatest artists, surrounding Michelangelo and Raffaello, designed and decorated the Pope's residences, churches, and palaces. Here we can see today the multiplicity of Baroque form. No one style has been supplanted by another, though now and then you come across a building which clearly has been added to in a later period and a later style. Works of art in layers, whose charm and fascination make Rome a city quite unique in the whole world. The slopes of Rome's capital hill, the Campidoglio, were once resplendent with Rome's most important temples. Today rises the white-stoned edifice known to Italians as l'Altare della Patria, the altar of the fatherland. Symbol of the unification of Italy, construction was begun at the end of the last century. The cost to us in archaeological losses was high. An entire medieval quarter was cleared away. Nevertheless, it serves today as a reminder of how the marble must have looked, which once covered all of Rome's buildings and monuments. The Fori Imperiali, the Roman courthouses and administrative center, were begun by Caesar at the side of the Foro Romano, already inadequate for a city that had become known as the capital of the world. Via dei Fori Imperiali leads to the Colosseum, the magnificent amphitheater built by the emperors of the Flavia family in the 100 years after Christ. It has become the symbol of Rome. After 2,000 years, attempts can be seen to preserve it from falling to pieces, inspired perhaps by what we can find in one of Lord Byron's epic poems. While stands the Colosseum, Rome shall stand. When falls the Colosseum, Rome shall fall. And when Rome falls, the world. The majestic edifice towers like a giant over the valley of the Domus Aurea pool of the sumptuous dwelling of Nero. The Church of Santa Maria in Araceli soars aloft atop the peak of the Campidoglio, where once stood the Temple of Giunone Moneta. The Michelangelo steps rise like a mountain road to the Piazza del Campidoglio, Michelangelo's Piazza. The summit of these unique steps is crowned by the twin late imperial statues of the Dioscuri, whose benevolent glances fall upon the city of which they were the protectors. From mythology, we learn that the Dioscuri were the sons of Giove and Leda, and that they fought by the side of the Romans at the Battle of Lake Regillo. They embellish the balustrade which encompasses the entrance to the piazza with its statues of Constantine, his son Constantine II, and the trophies of Mario. Four floors survive of a Roman working class habitation. This is an early example, dating back to the 2nd century AD, of a multi-floor construction for the lower income classes. Alongside the altar of the fatherland is the Caesar Forum, a long colonnaded piazza whose focal point was the temple of the Venus known as Venere Genitrice. It was once richly decorated with works of art, notably a collection of paintings from the most famous of Greek artists. Under the foundations of the little church of St. Joseph the Carpenter, we can still find the remains of the Roman prison, Il Carcere Marmettino Etulianum, where enemies of the state were put to death. It was here that the martyrs Peter and Paul awaited execution. Amongst the ruins of the Roman Forum, we can make out the triumphal arches celebrating the Roman conquests. That of Settimio Severo, between the Rostri and La Curia, with its beautiful proportions, and the fornix remaining of the Arch of Tito. The Roman Forum was the center of politics, religion, and commerce in the city. It was here that Rome's destiny was decided by rulers such as Sylla, Cicero, Julius Caesar, and Augustus. A series of reliefs on the arch of the Emperor Settimio Severo recount his victories in foreign lands. Some of Rome's temples were transformed into Christian churches. That of Antonino and Faustina is known today as San Lorenzo in Miranda. Nevertheless, the fascination of the Forum remains undiminished. From the Temple of Vesta to the imposing columns, the basilicas, all tell of the splendor which was Rome's. At the summit of the Via Sacra, we find Tito's archway. Its bas reliefs, which adorn the inner surfaces of its fornix, are among the maximum expressions of Roman art from the 1st century AD. Each side is decorated by four composite half columns, while the two keystones at the summit display the narrative of the talents of the Popolo Romano and of their city. These are the imposing ruins of the Masenzio Basilica, which was counted among Imperial Rome's greatest and grandest buildings. Much admired in its time was a colossal statue of Constantine, sculpted in a variety of materials. Gigantic pieces of this statue, resembling marble, are to be found today in the courtyard of the Museum Palazzo dei Conservatori on the Campidoglio. The bronze statue of Caesar in the Via dei Fori Imperiali is a reproduction of the marble original of Trajan times in the 1st century AD, while Augustus appears to be addressing the crowds with his wise discourses in the copy of the famous statue from Prima Porta. Greek and Romanesque classicism are smelted together in the most outstanding of the portraits of the emperor. The rectangular piazza was flanked by two semicircles in the Forum of Augustus, at the end of which stood out, high above, the Temple of Marte Ultore, known in English as Mars Ultor, the avenger of Caesar's murder. Adjacent to it is the huge three-story portico of the Trajan markets. Modern slabs in marble illustrate the expansion of the Roman Empire in different epochs. The Colosseum is perhaps so called for the colossal statue of Nero, which sprung up in its neighborhood. However, its more exact description is the Flavian amphitheater, since its construction was begun in the year 72 AD by a certain Vespasiano of the Flavia family. It was inaugurated 8 years later by his son Titus with great celebrations. The 80 archways of the ground floor served as entrances to the tiers of seats, which were all numbered, as were the tickets. Four archways only were not for numbered seats. One led to the imperial stand, while the other three were reserved for state dignitaries and distinguished guests. The Roman public was seated in different sections according to their social classes, with a capacity of more than 50,000 spectators. The tiers of seats nearest to the arena, constructed in marble, were reserved for the Senate. The entire area of the amphitheater was covered with a floor of wooden sections which hid from view all the backstage equipment, the machinery, the weapons, and the cages for the wild beasts. The spectators were protected from the wild beasts by a substantial net, and from the sun by a vast cloth awning, which could be drawn over their heads by 100 sailors from the port of Miseno. The Palatine, according to the legend, was where the wolf nourished the twins Romulus and Remus in a cave here, and it was on the Palatine that Romulus founded Rome. During the times of the Republic, the plateau became the residential quarter of the aristocrats and politicians, though never at any time of the populace. It became a sacred hill of emperors, poets, and patricians. Today, we can admire their imposing structures, decorated with precious marbles, and their decorated walls, terraces, porches, rows of columns, and baths, which leave to the imagination the splendor of the Roman Empire. The Romans paid great attention to the care and cleanliness of their bodies and built grandiose bathhouses, highly decorated with mosaics and precious marbles. In the city of Rome, no less than 14 aqueducts supplied water to the 11 public baths, to some 900 private baths, and about 2,000 fountains. An ingenious system of terracotta pipes behind their walls connected to boilers, which provided a hot air system of central heating. The baths were generally divided into three areas: il frigidarium, with its huge swimming pool; il tepidarium, which, as its name suggests, consisted of basins of tepid water; and il calidarium, which provided hot baths and even saunas. Here we see the great baths of Caracalla, among the best preserved in Rome, from the 3rd century AD. They cover an area of over 1 million square feet, and could accommodate 1,600 persons bathing. Mosaics and sculptures adorned every angle. Masterpieces have been unearthed, such as Hercules and the Farnese Bull, and the Belvedere Torso. Today, during the hot summer evenings, the ruins play host to performances of lyric opera in an extraordinarily successful open-air acoustic, and permit the staging of an unforgettable Aida with galloping horses, camels, and fireworks. In the 1st century before Christ, Caio Sestio Epulone, a tribune of the people, built himself his tomb in the form of a pyramid, which was incorporated by the Emperor Aurelius into his wall, close to the mighty Porta Ostiense, which also goes by the name of Porta San Paolo, modified and reinforced by Honorio in the 5th century. In the center of Piazza Argentina are to be seen the remains of the sacred area of Campo Marzio, with its four temples of the Republican era. The first temple to the right is from 3 centuries before Christ and has undergone various restorations. There is some doubt over its dedication, whether to Giunione Curitis or to Giuturna. At any rate, it was transformed in the Middle Ages into the little church of San Nicola di Calcario. A huge podium, fashioned out of blocks of tufa rock, is all that remains of Pompey's tribunal. It was here, on the Ides of March, 44 years before the birth of Christ, that Caius Julius Caesar was assassinated by young noblemen and senators who had plotted against him. He fell, covering his face with his toga, at the pedestal of Pompey's statue, his old rival, covering it with his blood. The Pantheon is the best preserved of the Roman monuments. One is awestruck by its grandiosity, its harmony, its originality of construction. It was begun by Agrippa, a century before Christ, to adorn Campo Marzio with a temple to all the gods. The Pantheon of today, however, dates from the time of Adriano. Sixteen enormous granite columns plunge into the foundations of this monument, which houses the tombs of Raffaello, Annibale Carracci, Baldassare Peruzzi, Taddeo Zuccari, and Vignola, all of them famous painters and most of them outstanding architects. A 20 feet thick cylindrical wall, alleviated by 8 niches, alternately semicircular and rectangular, supported the upper story of a hard Egyptian rock called porphyry, on which rests the gigantic cupola of stratified concrete, a masterpiece of Roman architecture. A perfect hemisphere, 142 feet in diameter, and as high again as the entire construction, it is certainly the widest ever constructed, and its masonry is composed of volcanic ash and pebble to reduce its mass. At its center is an aperture nearly 30 feet in diameter, which furnishes the light for the interior. The Piazza del Pantheon displays the 16th century fountain of Giacomo della Porta. In the middle stands an Egyptian obelisk taken from the Temple of Isis in Campo Marzio, just like the one in the nearby Piazza della Minerva, held upright by an elegant baby elephant designed by Gian Lorenzo Bernini, which has become known as the Little Chicken of Minerva, a nickname earned by its diminutive proportions. The plain lying between the Campidoglio, the Palatino, the Aventino, and the River Tiber was of the greatest importance from the first days of Rome. Here we discover the Foro Boario, with the temple attributed to Parthenos and the seat of government of Annona, upon which was built in the 7th century the church of Santa Maria in Cosmedin, whose interior is decorated with impressive works of art with its tall Romanesque bell tower. Below, in its porch, there is a circular hole in the wall, sculptured in Roman marble-like stone, representing the mask of a sea divinity. It is called La Bocca della Verità, the mouth of the truth. For legend has it that an erring wife, under suspicion of deceiving her husband, had her hand bitten off when interrogated here. The circular temple of the Foro Boario goes back to the 1st century BC. It was erroneously attributed to the goddess Vesta, who had a place of worship similar in form. The piazza is further enlivened by a charming Baroque fountain. The form of this little temple is surrounded by 20 Corinthian columns. Unhappily, the original beams used in the construction no longer exist. The Portico di Ottavia, dedicated to the sister of Augusto, was rectangular and enclosed the temples of Giove and Giunone, libraries and a meeting hall. The Appian Way was constructed 300 years before Christ by the consul Appio Claudio the Blind One and stretched as far as Capua. It was considered the most famous of the Roman roads for its width and its beauty and was called the Queen of Roads, Regina Viarum, by the poet Stazio in the 1st century AD. It was paved with flagstones of volcanic rock from the Lazio hills, and for long stretches there were well-kept footpaths. On either side stood the tombs of citizens. The tombs were of every conceivable shape and size, often covered with carvings and mouldings and portraits. To walk down the Via Appia is to find oneself among the archaeological remains stretching from antiquity to the Middle Ages in a setting of charming, characteristic countryside. One of the most impressive monuments on the Appia is the mausoleum of Cecilia Metella, the wife of the triumvirate Crasso, who accompanied Caesar in Gaul with the rank of general. This tomb is cylindrical on a square base, and the battlements we see today date from the Middle Ages. They are decorated by an elegant frieze composed of shields, festoons, and the skulls of oxen. This castle was built in medieval times by the nobles of Tuscolo and is next to Cecilia Metella's tomb. Along the Via Appia, we find the catacombs of San Sebastiano, which testify to the glorious period in the church's history of martyrs. In the church, the marmoreal sculpture of the holy martyr. While the Roman Empire was at the height of its splendor, little by little, and at first in secret, Christianity in Rome was born and began to develop. To recapture once again the atmosphere of that period, it's enough to descend into the long and intricate subterranean galleries of the catacombs. While still on the Via Appia, we can find the catacombs of San Callisto, dug out of the volcanic rock where the first Christians buried their dead. To facilitate the visits of the faithful to the more revered tombs, small rooms were realized, as is the case of the crypt of Santa Cecilia, which today is decorated with a copy of the famous statue by the 16th century sculptor Stefano Maderno. The tombs, hollowed out of the walls of the galleries and crypts, were sealed sometimes with slabs of marble, inscribed upon with the name of the deceased, and often with symbolic recognition. The paintings in the catacombs are inspired by the Old and the New Testaments. Jesus is often represented as the Good Shepherd leading home his lost sheep. All along the walls of these long galleries in tombs cut into the rock were laid to rest the first Christians to await the resurrection. Over the tombs of the martyrs would spring up subterranean church cemeteries, as in the case of the saints Nerero and Archileo in the catacombs of Domitilla, which in spite of being plundered and despoiled down the centuries, still holds a particular fascination today. The Catholic Church gained strength little by little from the catacombs. And when Constantine proclaimed the freedom of religious worship in his Edict of Milan in the year 313 AD, it was able at last to emerge into the light. And it began to penetrate, in a context of paganism, into all social classes until it reached even the imperial family. The model of Constantine's Rome gives us a complete picture of pagan Rome. From that period began the change in the appearance of the buildings of a Christian Rome, which changed its whole character. When the Emperor Hadrian gave orders for the construction of his mausoleum and the bridge which was designed to be its grandiose triumphal entrance, he could not have imagined the turn of events that would shape its destiny to become the strongest fortress in the whole of Rome. In the year 271 AD, the Emperor Aureliano made it into part of the Tiber's right bank fortifications. For the mausoleum at its beginning was a quadrangle base on which sat a cylindrical body ringed with columns. From medieval times, it was transformed into a castle in gratitude for the divine pardon which put an end to a terrible pestilence in the form of an angel who appeared at its tower with a flaming sword. The angel who, according to legend, performed this symbolic act was Sant'Angelo, from which the castle took its name. It also acquired notoriety as a prison for those awaiting execution, and among those who languished in its cells were famous names like the Cenci, Benvenuto Cellini, Giordano Bruno, and Count Cagliostro. The quiet and tranquil Piazza Farnese hosts the most beautiful 16th century palace in all of Rome, constructed with stone and marble taken from the antique monuments. The Palazzo Farnese was begun by San Gallo the Young, and was completed by Michelangelo and Giacomo della Porta. The peacefulness of the piazza is heightened by the murmur of water from the twin fountains, which splash into two huge bathtubs of Egyptian granite taken from the Caracalla baths. In front of the tiny church of Santa Brigida, a statue seems to be protecting the passers-by. At a distance of only a few hundred yards, the atmosphere changes to one of bustle and noise. Piazza Campo dei Fiori, with its teeming market stalls. At the center of all the confusion and noise rises the statue of Giordano Bruno on its tall plinth. It was here in February 1600 that he was burnt at the stake as a heretic, for his ideas were considered too advanced for his times. The monument by Ettore Ferrari was erected in 1887. Around its base are bronze reliefs of episodes in his turbulent life. The River Tiber was once a vital link in the life of the city, which was supplied by ships through a national network of canals. Today, isolated from the bustle of the metropolis by high walls, it courses lazily under its bridges, some of which go back to Roman times, like the Ponte Emilio, known also as Il Ponte Rotto, the broken bridge, for all that stands today is a supporting arch. Then there are the two bridges linking the Isola Tiberina, Il Fabrizio and Il Cestio. Legend has it that the island was formed from the mud that accumulated from the Tarquinian grain thrown into the river by the townspeople. Today we can see the hospital of the Fate Bene Fratelli, the Do-Well Friars, the Church of San Bartolomeo, and a charming building with a plaque which translated reads Hospital for the Israelite Community in Rome. From across the water towers the imposing synagogue, built nearly 200 years ago by the architects Armani and Costa in characteristically eclectic style with Assyrian and Babylonian features. During the first centuries AD, the area around the Via della Conciliazione consisted of a quiet sepulchral road flanked by humble mausoleums, for the most part pagan. And where the basilica stands today was the Circo di Caligula and Nerone. And there, a small space with a poor little tomb in the earth, where lay buried a man condemned to death by the most infamous of capital punishments, crucifixion on a cross. It was the tomb of the Apostle Peter, and in the 4th century, Constantine constructed a sumptuous basilica over that spot, which lies today right under the cupola of St. Peter's, which was rebuilt from the 1500s by the greatest architects of the Renaissance and Baroque eras. Vatican City, seat of the Pontiff, is one of the smallest sovereign states in the world. Yet in its territory of just a few acres, it houses one of the greatest art collections in the world of untold value. Its own security and police force are under the command of the Swiss Guards, founded in 1506. Still today, they wear the elegant multicolored uniforms, which were designed, it is said, by Michelangelo, to whose genius we owe the miracle of St. Peter's cupola. Vatican City comprises the Basilica, the Piazza, the Vatican palaces, the museums, churches, and the marvelous gardens. There is a Vatican railroad station, a heliport, a radio station, and the vast conference hall designed by Pierluigi Nervi. The great Bernini carried out the superb colonnade in St. Peter's Square to symbolize a gigantic paternal embrace of all Christendom. 284 gigantic Doric columns in four rows fix the limits of three promenades. The columns are so perfectly aligned that from a certain point in the piazza, which is marked, one sees only one row of columns around the entire semicircles. Two beautiful fountains enliven the whole view, one by Maderno, the other by Bernini. At the foot of the Michelangelesque steps that rise towards the basilica are two great 19th century statues, St. Paul with spade in hand and St. Peter holding the keys of the Kingdom of Heaven. Thank you. The splendid cupola, higher even than that of the Pantheon, is the work of Michelangelo, who devoted the last 18 years of his life to the Basilica. High up at a window in the Pontiff's palace, His Holiness presents himself on Sundays and feast days to address the crowds below who fill the square and to give his benediction. The ancient Egyptian obelisk at the center of the square was put there in 1586 by Domenico Fontana at the wish of Pope Sixtus V. At the summit of the basilica's frontage, amongst the statues of the apostles by Salvatore and San Giovanni Battista, two elegant clocks by Valadier stand out. They have told the pilgrims below the hour for the last 200 years. The interior of the basilica is simply a succession of masterpieces, one following the other. And we should like to pause before a work of art that can never be repeated, a miracle of the human genius which does not cease to amaze over the centuries, La Pietà of Michelangelo. Sculptured at the age of 25, it is pervaded by a strong symbolism. The body of Christ, quite perfect anatomically, and with no other signs of his martyrdom than the wounds from the nails of his crucifixion, lies completely abandoned in the arms of his mother. The sublime countenance of the Madonna, as ever very young in spite of age, suffused with the infinite purity of she who has never known sin, inclines over the lifeless body of Christ as though to clasp to her bosom her beloved Son, and symbolically all of suffering humanity. In the immensity of her grief, Mary would seem to open her arms in acceptance of divine will. The Sistine Chapel was constructed under Sixtus IV to serve the double function of pontifical chapel and a fortified shelter in time of need. The Pope had its walls frescoed by the greatest painters of the Renaissance. The ceiling of the chapel originally depicted a blue sky sprinkled with golden stars. Pope Julius II, at the beginning of the 16th century, wished to have the ceiling repainted with the 12 apostles. In spite of having at his disposition many famous painters, he turned to Michelangelo with what we might consider inspired intuition. Michelangelo interrupted his preferred passion for sculpturing and soon presented his patron with a design far more grandiose than envisaged, which had for its subject, in the center of the ceiling, a panorama of the salient events in the history of mankind. The great artist labored tirelessly for 4 long years in conditions of discomfort while refusing the aids employed by his contemporaries. The outcome was superb. The powerful images, richly subtle, emerge with force and dynamism from the ceiling. In his episode of Original Sin, it is the tree with the devil which underlines the border between the idyllic terrestrial paradise and the despair of being cast out into a wilderness without hope. In the creation of man, the gesture of the Creator bestowing life upon Adam by the simple stretching forth of the fingers is fascinating. Michelangelo had not completed his work in the Sistine Chapel, however. He was to return to complete 23 years later his insuperable masterpiece, Il Giudizio Universale, The Last Judgment. In the upper portion of the composition, the angels are carrying the implements of the Passion of Christ to justify his implacable judgment. In the lower, mankind is resurrected under the astonished gaze of the figure of death in order to be judged. Those judged to be guilty of sin are thrown down to where Charon, the mythological boatman, is waiting to carry them to hell. Quite terrible are the angels sounding their trumpets to awaken the dead and to rally them. At the center of the composition is a magnificent figure of Christ, awe-inspiring in his gesture of rejection of the wicked and benediction of the just. The martyrs surrounding him draw back in fear at the potency of that gesture. The Basilica of San Giovanni in Laterano, called the Cathedral of Rome, was built in the 4th century and afterwards was rebuilt and altered. Today we can admire the majestic frontage which Alessandro Algardi designed at the beginning of the 18th century. In the vestibule is a statue of the Emperor Constantine, which was brought from the Constantine Baths of the Quirinale in recognition of his generosity towards the Basilica in the form of bountiful precious gifts. The summit of the frontage is adorned with the 20-foot-high statues of Christ, San Giovanni Battista, San Giovanni Evangelista, and of Fathers of the Church. In the piazza of the Basilica, we find a modern monument by Giuseppe Tonini to the patron saint of Italy, St. Francis of Assisi. In his intense, enraptured expression, we glimpse the deep love in this saint, which led him to renounce his considerable earthly goods to become the poorest of the poor. A short distance away is the 16th century Porta San Giovanni, the grandiose design of Giacomo del Duca. The Basilica of San Paolo, since the 4th century, rises above the tomb of the apostle. In 1823 it was gutted by fire and afterwards was rebuilt as we can see it today, with its frontage adorned in rich mosaics representing four prophets, the Lamb of God, symbol of Christ on the hillside from which four streams pour out. At the center of the four-sided arcade which leads to the frontage, realized by Guglielmo Calderini, stands a huge statue of San Paolo by Giuseppe Obici. In the triangular pediment over the portico, we can see Christ in benediction between Saints Peter and Paul. Basilica's cloister are kept archaeological finds from the nearby necropolis and some fragments of the former basilica. Of great interest is the Roman sarcophagus, whose sculptured reliefs depict episodes in the mythology of Apollo. The 13th century cloister is one of Vassaletto's masterpieces, from a Roman family famous for sculpturing in marble. All four sides display small arches, all on a curve, supported by slender little columns, twin-coupled, simple, spiral, octagonal, or interlaced, whose marble is made the more precious with multicolored mosaics. The beams that run along above the little arches are decorated in great detail with mosaics and inlaid marble. Of the patriarchal basilicas is the 5th century Santa Maria Maggiore, whose frontage is by Ferdinando Fuga. In the center of its piazza stands the bronze statue of the Virgin with Child by Berthelot. The church of San Pietro in Vincoli is rich in works of art, but it is famous for the chains of St. Peter, as well as for the mausoleum of Pope Julius II by Michelangelo. Michelangelo's genius is also displayed in his superb statue of Moses with the Ten Commandments upon his descent from Mount Sinai, angry with his people for their worship of the golden calf. Legend has it that the chains preserved here are those which bound the imprisoned St. Peter in Palestine and afterwards in Rome, miraculously joined together. Michelangelo also proved his talents as architect in his impressive and grandiose church of Santa Maria degli Angeli on the site of the Tepidarium, an intermediate heating room of the Diocletian Baths. He raised up to the level of imperial Roman art that of his profound adherence to the Renaissance. Piazza del Popolo, spacious in its eloquence, with its twin churches from the 17th century, which we will translate as St. Mary of the Holy Mountain and St. Mary of Miracles. In the 19th century, Giuseppe Valadier, considered the first modern Italian architect, replanned the piazza with its two arcades with marble sphinx and the four seasons. In the middle of each sphinx is an elegant fountain decorated with marble statues. The obelisk with its four lions disgorging water goes back to 13 centuries before Christ. It was brought to Rome during the reign of Augustus, designed for the Circo Massimo. To one side of Piazza del Popolo is the Pincio, the fascinating public gardens planned by Valadier that still preserve an enchanting water clock on an island. The Pincio commands a view of part of the city beyond Piazza del Popolo and is crisscrossed with avenues lined with statues and fountains. Piazza Navona, a harmonious, ample space, scanned by spectacular fountains and closed in by high palatial houses. They follow exactly the shape of the Domiziano Stadium upon whose ruins they sit today. Three great fountains were placed in the piazza. Facing the Panfili Palace is La Fontana del Moro, with its two basins, created in 1574 by Giacomo della Porta. The statue of the Moor at the center of this composition was sculpted by Giovan Antonio Mari in 1655, based on a sketch by Bernini. Facing the Church of Sant'Agnese, the Christian girl who was martyred in this very stadium, we cannot fail to be struck by the Fountain of the Great Four Rivers of Gian Lorenzo Bernini in 1651. A reef of rocks supports at its center a Roman obelisk that was previously in the Circo di Masenzio on the Appian Way. From a grotto among the sculptured rocks emerges a lion and other imaginative animals, while there are seated the personifications of the Nile, the Ganges, the Danube, and the River Plate from the four corners of the then known world, Africa, Asia, Europe, and the Americas. This fountain also was commissioned by Pope Innocenzo X Panfili, whose coat of arms stands out on the rocks. The fantasy of the Roman people has found in the postures of the four figures scope for its love of gossip and scandal. Thus, the rivalry between Bernini and the architect of the church Borromini is clearly expressed in these figures for the Romans. Thus, the Nile is hiding its face not because its source was as yet undiscovered, but quite clearly because it didn't wish to be forced over the years to gaze upon the constructural errors of Borromini. The figure of the River Plate, worse still, fears the imminent collapse of the church. Borromini becalms these fears with his statue of Sant'Agnese's reassuring hand on her breast. During the Middle Ages, the piazza was the scene of wild carnivals, which became ever more extravagant during the Renaissance. From the mid-17th century to the 19th, every Saturday and Sunday during August, the piazza was flooded at its center island and became the theater of wildly cheered coach races between the Roman nobility. Much the same as the perimeter of the Domitian Stadium, which in ancient times had entertained with conquests of every type, nautical, athletic, equestrian, and musical. And this is the queen of the fountains of Rome, the world-famous Fontana di Trevi, which in its capricious 18th century style of Nicola Salvi would seem to have been inspired by Bernini. It is a monumental showpiece of the Aqua Vergine, which already flowed into Rome a century before Christ. In an animated theatrical scene of water coursing over rocks, towers the figure of Neptune in a chariot drawn by two seahorses driven by sea gods. The fountain was inaugurated in 1735 by Pope Clement XII, whose coat of arms can be seen between two winged goddesses of fame. To the sides of the ocean, two rectangular niches give shelter to the two allegorical statues, L'Abbondanza and La Salute, by Filippo della Valle. Above the statue representing Abundance is the relief sculpture of Agrippa, who ordered the construction of the aqueduct. The statue representing health is carried the poetic legend of how the water came to be called Virgin, from a young girl who had once shown the source to Agrippa's army when it was in need. Everybody would seem to believe in the charming custom of throwing a coin over one's shoulder into the fountain to ensure one's return. Via dei Condotti hosts the most prestigious shops and fashion houses in Rome. Its famous Café Greco was founded in 1700 and frequented by the illustrious from culture and the arts, Goethe, Stendhal, Franz Liszt, and Leopardi, amongst others. Then we find ourselves in that multiform, picturesque and romantic space that is Piazza di Spagna, with its theatrical flight of steps from the 18th century Francesco di Santis, leading to the church of Trinità dei Monti. The steps are always crowded with every type, and there is much sitting and sprawling and soaking up the sun. All around here live artists and poets. In the Romantic period of the 19th century, the English poet John Keats lived and died in the little red house at the foot of the steps on the right. In the center of the piazza, the Fontana della Barcaccia, the old boat, by Bernini's father Pietro, records an actual embarkation from this very point during the disastrous flooding of the Tevere in 1598. In the last century, it was hopeful artist models who paraded here in their picturesque peasant costumes, waiting to be engaged by the artists who had their studios in nearby Via Maguta. In use of Bernini, the picturesque Fontana del Tritone in Piazza Barberini. The great representative of Roman Baroque was commissioned by Pope Urbano VIII, Barberini, to decorate the piazza where stands the palace which Barberini had just completed. At the center of its basin stands a sea god with a Roman trumpet, spouting water into the air and running into the valves of a seashell supported by four dolphins emerging from the water. To complete the decoration of the fountain is the characteristic coat of arms with the bees of the Barberinis, crowned by the pontifical tiara. This spectacular fountain, with all the energy and ornamentation of Baroque art, displays a monumental purity of form which re-echoes classicism. This motive of the bees as a symbol of the Barberinis can be seen in another fountain by Bernini, a few yards across the square at the bottom of the Via Veneto. Here the bees spurt water in their seashell. The imposing Palazzo Barberini has become the National Gallery of Art, with valuable paintings from the 14th to the 19th century and beyond. Via Veneto was the meeting place of the easy living of the 50s, called La Dolce Vita, with its rows of cafes and shops and several luxury hotels which fill the pavements with well-off tourists. Palazzo Montecitorio, begun by Bernini, is today Italy's House of Commons or Parliament. The President of the Republic resides in the Palazzo del Quirinale, whose construction was begun in 1574. Piazza opposite are the two great statues of the Dioscuri on horseback, Roman copies of the original Greek statues. The fountain of the Naiadi del Guerrieri is somewhat the symbol of today's Rome. It stands at the center of the spacious Piazza della Repubblica and is the exact shape of a great colonnade from the Diocletian baths, ornamented with charming brass statues by Mario Rutelli. Four groups of statues represent feminine figures, the Naiadi, playing with marine animals. The sculpture in the center represents man's triumph over the forces of nature. Nearby is the Church of Santa Susanna. Its animated frontage is by Carlo Maderno. Our trip through Rome is almost concluded. Now we can dive into one of those narrow streets of Trastevere, looking for the real Roman spirit, carefree and rebellious, but all heart. We can plunge into one of the thousands of trattorias and sample the marvelous Roman kitchen. Or we can go up to the Gianicolo and stop by the 17th century Fontana Paola to embrace the whole city below in one glance from the hill where Garibaldi, the hero of two continents, led his heroic defense of the Roman Republic. We can listen to the peaceful murmur of the water from the late Renaissance Fontana delle Tartarughe, the tortoises of Taddeo Landini. To this Florentine sculptor, we owe his elegant bronze adolescence and his agile dolphins. The tortoises were added to the fountain later in the 17th century, probably by Bernini when the basin was enlarged. We can also discover modern buildings of some interest, like the Palace of Justice, to which the Romans jokingly refer as that ugly great palace. In the very center of Rome today, we can still find a peaceful corner in the Emperor Augustus Mausoleum. Its circular base stands upon a tomb of earth planted with cypress trees. It can be found in the center of Piazza Augusto Imperatore, next to the Arapaces and some splendid churches, in one of the most suggestive parts of this city.